funny, I hardly knew ya.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining us this evening at the Downing Family Theater. Now, the Downing Family Theater has been silent for about 50 years. It's been a long time since there's been a performance in this venue. But this theater has been renovated for you tonight. And we have a very special play for you tonight. It's called A Sword for the Centuries. And I think you will enjoy it. You're going to meet many interesting characters, and you're going to travel backwards in time. 150 years, a century and a half.
Good.
Now, I bet most of you know about time travel. You can't just jump back in time. You have to go step by step. And our first step starts with Ryan Patrick Downing. Thank you for joining us on stage, Ryan. Ryan, I wonder if you would mind answering a few questions about yourself. Ryan, where were you born?
I was born in Saugus, California.
And where do you live now?
I live in Saugus, California.
Can you tell us what grade you are in school?
I'm heading in fourth grade.
So you're going to be in fourth grade this year. Are you having a nice summer?
I am.
What are you doing this summer?
I've just done with my, I've played soccer, I've played lots of sports. I finished my junior lifeguarding, which was a great accomplishment for me. And that's about it.
Wonderful, thank you, Ryan. One more thing before you leave us. Would you introduce us to your father?
My father's name is Patrick Joseph Downing.
Patrick, would you come join us up here? So Patrick, tell us, where were you born?
I was born in Berea, Ohio, in a small home very similar to this, as a matter of fact. There it is!
How did you get from Berea, Ohio to Saugus, California?
I drove.
Tell us a little bit about your family.
Well, this is my lovely wife, Jeannie, who could not be with us here tonight because she's in Kaiser, but you know, she'll be here tomorrow. That, of course, is me. Jeannie had one wonderful daughter, one not so much. Amanda. Kristen, and then we had our son, Ryan Patrick Downing. We're going to call him Riley, but we already had a dog named Riley, and we know the girls would say, you named him after the dog, and you know you like the dog better. So we thought Ryan would be a good name for Ryan Patrick Downing.
Thank you, Pat. Would you tell us, what do you do?
I work for the city of Santa Clarita, yes. Doing special events. For the city of Santa Clarita.
Wonderful. Thank you.
Oh, you're welcome.
And before you leave us this evening, would you introduce us to your father?
Well, that could be hard. But if my dad was here, it would be Bert Downing.
Albert Louis Downing.
That would be correct.
Now we're traveling back in time.
Oh my God.
Good. How are you, Dad? Oh, you shrunk. Got a little bigger, though, Dad.
Very nice.
You made
it. Camera puts on 15 pounds.
Thank you for joining us, Bert, at the Downing Family Theater tonight. Tell us, where were you born?
Well, actually, I was born in Cincinnati in 1920. And just a little history in case you're interested.
Yes.
Okay. I also lettered in swimming, and I know that Ryan is doing really well in swimming in high school. Then I went on to Xavier College, and then I left to go to the seminary. in Milford, Ohio.
Oh, this is a picture of you here as a seminarian.
Yes, thank you.
Very interesting.
Yeah, and then as a good veteran.
Had a little hair back there, didn't you?
I decided to volunteer for the Army Air Corps, and I was a sergeant, and I was in the South Pacific Theater. And then I met this beautiful, wonderful woman.
Tell us.
Her name was Mary Ann. And actually...
Hager.
And my brother, that was a priest, actually set us up in the mission circle.
Ooh!
On that... Whoa!
Tell us what you did for a living.
Well, at that point, I was in radio sales.
Oh.
And I worked for... a broadcast group in Cincinnati, and we had five wonderful children, two in Cincinnati, three in Cleveland, and then we moved up to Cleveland, and I worked for KYW in Cleveland, and then I worked for this great new radio station that had a thing called FM, and it was WDBN. I had a short little jaunt with the fish, with blue fish, forget about that, and let's see here. Then I worked for World Book, and that was it.
Thank you for sharing that with us, Bert.
Mm-hmm.
And one more thing before you go.
Mm-hmm.
Could you introduce us to your father?
Sure.
Because we're traveling backwards in time.
Right. He's right in here,
yep.
And I'll get him. Oh, here he is!
Hi, I'm Bertie.
Charlie Chaplin.
Dennis, darling, thank you for joining us here. There's a picture of you.
You look great.
Where were you born? Dennis?
I was born in Washington, D.C. The capital of your country, you know, right? Right here in America it was.
And in August
of 12th, I have my 140th birthday coming up in a week and a half. I hope you all send me presents.
140th birthday and born in Washington, D.C. Well, tell us, if you would, about your family.
I had a lot of children. Oh, Jesus, it was a lovely time, baby. But Bert was always my favorite.
Thank
he was
you.
The best child ever, I tell you. The runt of the litter, end of the line, but the best. Absolutely. And I had a priest there. He went to Kathmandu. Had a lot of influence on the kids there at St. Xavier, I believe.
Yes, Father Tom.
Father Tom, yes, it was.
Very good. So, what did you do in your life?
I worked hard raising the family, mind you. But I worked for the railroads. I was in transportation. I did the streetcars. I started in Washington. I got transferred myself to Cincinnati. The trains ran on time, and then I died.
Wow. You worked hard every day. You provided for that family.
It was hard work, but I did it. I did it well, and I did it on time.
That's right. Well, thank you for joining us. Just one more thing before you go. Could you introduce us to your father?
The Colonel himself?
The Colonel!
Oh, Jesus, of course I can. Ah, how are you here? Come on up now.
Oh, my.
Well done.
Thank you. Good to be here.
Thank you for being here, traveling all this way, a century and a half to be with us here today. Can you tell us, where were you born?
I was born in 1837 in Ireland, in County Cork, in the little town of Skibbereen.
In a little town of Skibbereen, not even this country, but in Ireland.
In Ireland.
Tell us about Skibbereen.
Skibbereen is the southernmost town in Ireland. It's a small little town. Some of you have been there, I understand. Have you been to Skibbereen, ma'am?
Yes.
Well, isn't it a lovely town?
Yes, it is.
Yes, it is. It had some hard times, though. It did.
Tell us about those hard times.
Oh, in 1845, when I was just about 7 years old, the potato blight came in, and we had a great famine throughout the whole country. Skibbereen was hit particularly hard. As a matter of fact, they've written a song about it. Would you like to hear that?
Yes.
Well, then let's listen.
Oh, Father dear, I oftentimes hear you speak of Erin's Isle. Her lofty scenes, her valleys green, her mountains rude and wild. They say it is a lovely land wherein a prince might dwell. Oh, why did you abandon it? The reason me to tell. Oh, son, I loved my native land with energy and pride, till a blight came over all our crops and the sheep and cattle died. My rent and taxes were to pay, I could not them redeem. And that's the cruel reason why I left old Skibbereen. Oh, well, I do remember that cold December day. The landlord and the sheriff came to drive us away. They set our roof on fire with the demon's yellow gleam. And that's another reason why I left old Skibbereen. Oh, Father dear, the day may come when vengeance loud will call, when Irishmen are feeling stern to rally one and all. I'll be the man to lead the van beneath that flag of green, when loud and high we'll raise the cry, revenge for Skibbereen. When loud and high we'll raise the cry, revenge for Skibbereen.
So many people left Skibbereen,
yes. We did not. My father was a merchant, and he was able to survive, but many did. My father, Mortimer, was in fact a member of the Poor Law Union, which helped provide welfare for the folks. Now, you saw the fellow there in that last stanza. Well, you saw him in a mugshot there. That was my cousin Jeremiah O'Donovan Rossa. You may know the name, Naggy, do you?
Yes.
I know you know the name Skibbereen. I heard you singing the song and all. Well, Donovan Barossa was our cousin.
I'm not going to sing a song.
You did. I saw you singing the song.
We're all having a good time.
Okay. Well, Donovan Barossa came and lived with us after his family went to America during the famine. And we were not very happy with the British. They had occupied our land, and we deserved better. We didn't want the freedom. And so along with Jeremiah and my brother Dennis and the other Downings in Skibbereen, we formed the Phoenix Literary Society. It sounds like a book club, but it really was kind of subversive.
Oh.
And the British found out about us. And we were out training one time, doing some drilling. And that was the first time I got arrested. Well, they arrested us, and we actually didn't stay in jail too long. My cousin Jeremiah, then he went on up to Dublin and became the editor of the Irish People's newspaper there. And that got him in a lot of trouble. He was arrested and sentenced to life imprisonment. And eventually he got exiled They let him out of jail, and you saw those pictures of the man eating out of a bowl?
Yeah.
Well, during this time in jail, they kept him bound up, and that was the way he was forced to eat. They treated him terribly, terribly, terribly.
Like a dog.
Like a dog. Like a dog.
What happened to you?
So his happened to me. Well, I went to see James Stevens in Paris, and he sent me on to America. This was around just before the Civil War started. And I met my wife, Margaret Jane Spillane. She was from this Cork, County Cork area also. And I married her, and we started our family with Mortimer.
You had a large family.
We did. I'm very proud of him. Mortimer went on to become an organizer with the Wobblies, with the IWW. He spent his time in jail, too. He was in Leavenworth Penitentiary during World War I for having protested against the war. They were political prisoners, many of them in Camp Leavenworth. Ross Downing became a very famous lawyer, a civil rights lawyer in Washington, D.C. Margaret went on to found and work with Big Sisters organization. She was the leader of that group. John was an engineer in Maryland, and Dennis, well, you've met Dennis over here.
Hi.
He took the railroads out to Cincinnati. Catherine, she was a clerk of courts in Washington, D.C. Patrick Downing was a professor at Fordham University. We come from a very literate lot. Yes. And then Robert Barry Downing was a member who helped build the Panama Canal down in Panama.
Very hardworking family.
We have a good, good family.
Yes.
Well, somewhere around the time after Mortimer was born, we then got into the war. Three of my brothers, all four of us, were in the war. Myself and my brother Dennis were members of the 42nd Battalion, known as the Regiment, the Tammany Regiment.
And so that's you?
That is me.
And that's
can you tell me about
Dennis?
My beard?
Yes.
See?
The I
beard
see
is so.
I see the resemblance.
And Dennis was my youngest brother. He was barely 18 at the time that he came and joined us in the war. Now, Dennis was a born leader. He became a captain, and he had a favorite song that he would use. Because you must understand that at this time, many of the Irish, because they didn't want the British to stay in Ireland, needed to learn more about fighting them. So many of the Irish came over and to learn the art of warfare by going through the Civil War. And they were both on the Union side and on the Confederate side, depending on where their people had come already. And so you'd have Irishmen fighting Irishmen, but learning again the art of war so they could take it back and take it to the British. At the Battle of Fredericksburg, there's a story about Dennis and how he led the song to encourage his troops. Would you like to hear about that story?
Aye.
This was published in the Irish People out of New York on March 9th of 1867. And it talks about the song called Hooray Boys Hooray, Ireland Boys Hooray. The writer wrote, I may also mention that the evening echoes were disturbed in Virginia many a time oft when Captain Downing sat at his tent door and let off this popular chant, the entire Irish brigade taking up the chorus. On the night after the bloody Battle of Fredericksburg, the Federal Army lay sleepless and watchful on their arms, with spirits damped by the loss of so many gallant comrades. To cheer his brother officers, Captain Downing sang his favorite song. The chorus of the first stanza was taken up by the gallant regiment. Next the brigade, next by the division, and then the entire army for 6 miles along the river. And when Captain Downing ceased, it was but to listen with indefinable feelings to the chant that came like an echo from the Confederate lines on the opposite shore. Dear old Ireland, brave old Ireland, Ireland boys, hurrah. I think I can hear Dennis. Maybe we want to sing along with him on the chorus here.
Deep in Canadian woods we've met, from one bright island flown. Great is the land we've tread, but yet our hearts are with our own. And ere we leave the shanty small, we'll fade the autumn day. We toast old Ireland, dear old Ireland, Ireland by us array.
Ireland by us array, Ireland by us array. We toast old Ireland, dear old Ireland, Ireland by us array.
We've heard her faults 100 times, the new ones and the old, in songs and sermons, rants and rhymes, in large some 50-fold. We take them all, both great and small, and this we've got to say. Here's dear old Ireland, good old Ireland, Ireland by us array.
Ireland by us array, Ireland by us array. Here's dear old Ireland, good old Ireland. Ireland by its array.
We know that brave and good men tried to snap her rusty chain, that patriots suffered, martyrs died, and all 'tis said in vain. But no, boys, no, a glance will show how far we've won our way. Here's good old Ireland, loved old Ireland, Ireland by its array.
Ireland by its array, Ireland by its array. Here's good old Ireland, loved old Ireland, Ireland by its array.
Happy and bright the groups that pass from peaceful homes for miles, o'er fields and roads and hills to mass when Sunday morning smiles. And deep their zeal, their true hearts feel when low they kneel to pray. Oh dear old Ireland, blessed old Ireland, Ireland by its array.
Ireland by its array, Ireland by its array. Oh dear old Ireland, blessed old Ireland, Ireland by its array.
Deep in Canadian woods we've met and we never may see again. The dear old Isle where our hearts are set, our first fond hopes remain. But come fill up another cup, and with every sup let's say, here's loved old Ireland, good old Ireland, Ireland by its array.
Ireland by its array,
hooray!
Ireland by its array,
hooray!
Here's loved old Ireland, good old Ireland, Ireland by its array.
Well, that was a terrible war, was that Civil War. Poor Dennis, the Battle of Gettysburg. We both fought at Gettysburg. Dennis had his foot blown off.
Oh,
had to have it amputated. That sort of ended his, well, it didn't end his military career. He went on, they say that he was present at the hanging of Mrs. Surratt, one of the assassins of President Lincoln.
Did you ever make it back to Ireland?
I never made it back, but I ended up, well, I did get out of the country once. Yes, the Fenians that we were working with, the Irish rebels, they decided one way to take the war back to England was to invade Canada.
Oh.
So we ended up invading Canada and won for a little while. But we got there and didn't know what to do with it. So they kicked us on out. We came back, got arrested again, and got released again. But we did work with the Irish Brotherhood. I was secretary of the Irish Brotherhood that helped make financial contributions towards freedom in Ireland.
So this would be like a regiment that you would have led.
That is correct. That would be the Irish Brigade.
And this is the regiment flag. I see the harp of Ireland.
Yes.
I see. Yes. So when you led the troops into battle.
With my sword here?
You used your sword.
Absolutely. And we led them on.
To lead them.
That's true.
Right. So what do you do with the sword now?
Well, I have no practical use for it. Ireland is free now.
Right.
Perhaps I should entrust it to my son.
You could do that here right now.
My son's right here.
Yes.
So Dennis.
Yeah.
With this sword, remember that at times when you are scared, you can be brave and do the right thing.
I will. Now that I got this sword, what am I going to do with it? I'm dead. Bernie. Give me that. With his sword. Remember, at times when you were scared, you can back up. And you can be brave and do what is right.
I will. Patrick?
Huh?
With this sword, remember that at all times when you are scared and you can be brave and do basically the right thing.
Uh-huh. An old sword. Thanks.
Don't be a comedian.
Well, how much I get on eBay for this?
100.
Wow. What should I do with a sword? I don't need a sword. It's only worth $100 on eBay. Maybe I'll give it to my son.
Wow.
Boom. There.
Here, son. Here's a sword. I shouldn't sell on eBay because it's been passed down from every generation. So I'm going to give it to you so you can pass it down to your son and you can be brave and have courage. Here you go. Be careful, it's sharp.
I have one more question for you. You know what this sword means to our family. It means that at times when you are scared, you can be brave and do the right thing. And our family is entrusting it to you. Will you take care of it?
I will.
Thank you. Thank you. concludes our performance.
Wonderful.